Welcome to Super Agents Live. This is the one place where you can come and hear the most successful people in real estate. You'll hear how these super agents built their businesses, how they stay productive, and how they stay motivated. Who am I? My name's Toby Salgado, and I made my first million in real estate. And I'm your host for the next 30 minutes while we talk to yet another amazing real estate entrepreneur. Stay tuned.
Let's go.
Ladies and gentlemen, guys and gals, hey, everybody, thank you so much for tuning in to Super Agents Live. If you're new to the show, welcome. I appreciate you coming on. And what we do on the show is we talk with top producing agents, coaches, authors, and we find out how they did it. I'm lucky enough to be able to ask them how they did it. All right. So if you don't know, the show hashtag is hashtag unpack that idea. Now, if you haven't used this, this is a big follow train, and I'm telling you, man, it's working. People, I talked to one girl last week. She had 7 followers. And by the way, she only did like three tweets. She had 7 followers. She now has 307. So on average, what people are finding is they're getting 100 to 300 by using the hashtag. Okay, listen, here's what today's show is about. I did this episode a while back, and I kind of didn't know where to fit it into the show. This guy, we get really deep on mindset. We get deep on mindset and visualization. This guy is an author. He wrote a book called The Conscious Millionaire. Now, I haven't released this episode because I just didn't, again, know where it fit in with you know, what was happening for the week or whatever. Now, here's the deal. Why am I releasing it today? It's this. Let me take a couple minutes here. Let me tell you about a story that happened to me. I talk with, again, really high level guys on the show. I've become friends with a lot of these guys. And over the last few months, I've sort of been migrating around this one group. Now, this group are all, man, there's about 10 of these guys. They all make between $3 and $5 million bucks a year. And they get together. They do crazy stuff. They do a winter trip. They go to Norway. They go to Africa, whatever. And then they do a summer trip. I was super honored that last week, you know, I was chatting with one of the guys in this group, and he said, "Hey, Toby, like, come on, like, you're invited to our next event." And you know, it's we get together in Mastermind. Well, I will be getting together. They get together, but now, you know, we'll see if I'm part of the group or not. I'm certainly going to do this next event. Now, you know, one of the guys has a 6,000 square foot house in Steamboat Springs, Colorado. And, you know, it costs $2,000. Everybody pitches in $2,000 to cover the cost of the house. And we hire, you know, a personal chef will be hired, and, you know, the wine and drinks and all that stuff. So, again, I'm super honored to be a part of it. And I got to thinking, I was like, not everybody has access to those guys, right? I didn't have access till I just got invited. And even if you did have access, you may not have an extra $2,000 to plop down for a weekend mastermind. So here's what I was thinking. You know what? We can do a mini version of this. So I've picked a date. We're going to do this, man. So I picked a date. It's June. I'm looking at the calendar right now. June 20th is Friday, June 20th. And, so that's about 3 weeks out. And here's, so I want to have 10 of you guys, maybe 12 of you guys. Let's do this. Let's all pitch in. We'll rent a suite here in San Diego. So we'll rent a suite in a hotel room. We'll either cater it or we'll have food delivered or whatever. And we'll do an all day mastermind, right? Start at 9 a.m., 10 a.m. Again, I literally just came up with this morning. And then we'll run it till 5. So I'm doing it on Friday because who knows? You know, somebody might be coming from overseas to do this. Somebody might be flying from New York to do this. I don't know. But if you're interested, if this sounds interesting to you, send me an email, Toby, T-O-B-Y, at Super Agents Live, and we'll get on the list. And again, I want to keep it small, 10 to 12. If I get like 100 requests, we'll figure something else out. Maybe we'll like rent a, I don't know what we're going to do. Anyhow. All right. So would love to see you there. I think it's going to be exciting. Let's get to the show. Today's guest is a speaker, author, And his latest book, his latest best-selling book, is The Conscious Millionaire. Today, we're going to talk about mindset and why it's critical to your success, not only in business, but in life. I'm thrilled to welcome my guest, JV Crum III. Hey, JV, thanks for taking the time out today.
Well, Toby, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, no problems. So listen, you have a very rich background, very rich career. You know, maybe take a minute, tell us a little bit about how you got to where you're at today and what you're currently working on.
Sure. Well, you know, since we're talking about mindset today, as you were doing that introduction, I thought, you know, the right place to start was when I was 5 years old.
Wow.
Because that was the moment. I had this moment in time. I grew up. I want to give you this picture of how I was growing up. It was this little country town, like 300 or 400 people in the middle of Florida. We're on this big lake. And nobody had any money. Everybody was like, my dad was in agriculture. My mom was a school teacher. Everybody just kind of got by. And there was there were a lot of times like we weren't exactly sure where the money was coming from just to have food. So by the time I was five, I had heard enough of those little family fights of, you know, can we afford this? I knew when we went to the grocery store not to ask for the candy bar because I knew the money wasn't there. And there was this one day that I'm sitting there, you know, little kids are just filled with wonder. And a lot of times, in fact, people go, well, how is it that you create the visualization, that you create the ability to believe in something that's so different than what you have right now? And for real estate agents, that's important every day because of all the no's they get, because of all the turndowns, because of all the open houses that people come and they kick the tires, and really it was a waste of time a lot of times. And it's definitely a game of numbers. So a lot of times being able to go back to where we were as little kids when we could believe in fantasies and pretend worlds and we'd be kings and queens or superheroes. So one day I was sitting there as little boys would do, little girls would do, and saying, well, what's the answer to this problem that we've never seemed to have enough money? And then, you know, in that little boy wonder, I said, oh, I've got the answer. When I grow up, I'm going to be a millionaire. So I run in the house, I tell it to my parents, and I recall my mother shaking her finger at me and saying, don't tell anyone. Now, there's a lot of stories in that one little story because, first of all, I changed my mindset literally in a few moments. And my mindset never changed after that. I always believed I was supposed to be a millionaire and got to there when I was about 25 years old. And I had the house on the water. I had the Mercedes, you know, all the things that most people dream about I had very early on. But it was because 20 years earlier, I had made a decision and I had created a mindset. By the time I was eight, I was drawing pictures of little, well, big mansions. I'd never been in a mansion, but you know, it's kind of funny because you know, we create the things that are reference points for us. Well, at 8 years of age, you're not particularly that worried about bedrooms. In fact, you don't even want to go to bed. So I didn't have any bedrooms in the house. I just had these three big dining rooms, one for breakfast, one for lunch, and one for dinner. I had this huge room to have parties. And the whole back of the house was this outdoors with a big pool and cabanas. And, you know, all I was thinking about as eight is I just want to have a lot of parties and places to eat and have fun. So that was my ideal mansion back then. But the thing was, when I sat down to write this book, and this is relating to mindset, I wondered, well, my mom had my best interest at heart. So why would she say to a little boy of five and shaking her fingers, why would she have told me, don't tell anybody? Well, by the way, of course, you should know, I went around and for a year and a half, I told everybody in town, when I grow up, I'm going to be a millionaire.
Of course.
I don't think, yeah, of course, because little kids are going to do that, especially when their mom says, don't do it. But I believed it. I don't know if anybody else did. Didn't matter to me. So, but the point was, I said, why would she have said that? And I thought about it, and it really goes to beliefs, which is at the core mindset. My parents were really good people. We went to church three times a week. We lived across the street from the church. And I realized what she wanted was she wanted to be sure her son grew up to be a good person. And in her mind, because there was a lot of scarcity mentality in my family, someone couldn't grow up and have that much money and be super successful financially without having done something wrong.
Right.
And she didn't want me to grow up to do something wrong. And I'm bringing this up at the start because everyone that I've worked with, and I coach clients, there's usually a core belief about worthiness, about deserve. There'll be a piece sometimes about, you know, it's wrong, it's not good. There's an inner conflict that you can't live these values of honesty and integrity and make money, which really brought me to creating Conscious Millionaire, because I said, no, that's not true at all. It's not how I've made any of my money. I've always been honest. I've always had integrity. You know, it's always been about adding value to people's lives. But we're walking around with all these mixed up beliefs that come from so many different places in our life. A lot of time, like my mom, with good intention, she wanted the best for me. But in her mind, the best was that I couldn't grow up and have a lot of money because I had to have done something wrong. And I'm wondering, right now, when people are listening to this, how many people identify that somewhere inside there's at least an inkling of a belief that they could they can imagine is there that's holding them back because they don't truly believe they can be a good person, or they don't think that they're worthy or deserve to really have the financial success that they keep saying on a daily basis they want.
Right. Sorry, I didn't mean to stop you there if you were going to go on a little bit more, but that ties into a question I had, right? So you said earlier that you were the kid walking around the store and you didn't ask for a candy bar because you just knew it wasn't possible.
Well, I was told not to ask.
Right, right. And you get told that enough times, you're like, I'm not going to ask. So
I don't have the money for the extra candy bar.
So, I mean, so you're a five-year-old kid. You were trained that, listen, I can't ask for just a simple candy bar because we don't have the cash. You lived in a city where everybody sort of lived this way. Right. What is it about you, JV, that how come you didn't fall into that trap of just being a drone and just saying, well, look, I got to be a bad guy or live poor, right? Like, because equating negative things with
it's a great question. I've been on so many interviews lately. That seems to be a favorite question. Oh, so I'm damn. Yeah, I've had that question.
I wish I wouldn't have asked it then. I thought that was a unique question.
I think it's a great question because it actually makes me ponder every time. Well, how is it that my life turned out so differently when I don't think I'm that different from the average person? I simply made a decision, and it really goes to the heart of visualization. And everybody, I'm sure on this call, has been taught some form of visualization and is familiar with the visualization, has probably visualized selling a house when they did an open house or when they met with a client. They visualized and they rehearsed in advance. What I found, because I created a special way to visualize, and why don't we talk about that? Because I really want to give some skills to people. I coach clients and I believe in giving real hard results kind of skills that people get value out of. So the way I visualize, the way I teach visualization is very different. Most visualizations, they have you get the picture. Okay, so that's the first piece. What I call that's the conscious step. And then they have you focus just your mind. And then they have you imagine, you know, taking action by moving into the future. I have not found that to be a very effective way to visualize. And by effective, I mean I want results. If I'm going to do something, I want to get the results it's designed to get. So let's go over step by step how I teach visualization and how I do it, and I get tremendous results from it. Yeah. So the first step is conscious. So you want to get a rich sensory, visual, auditory, kinesthetic picture of all those senses in detail. And sometimes it's useful just to write that out initially and get that picture and those feelings in your mind. Now, that's fairly similar to the first step of most visualizations, but the second step is extremely different because they have you focusing with your mind. Here's the problem. You need to focus with your whole being. You need to focus with your mind, with your heart, and with your physical body in a state of readiness to take action. But let's talk about the heart. A lot of people have probably heard of the Heart Math Institute. You can go there, you can Google that. And they've found that the energy radiating out of your heart is 5,000 times stronger than the energy that's coming out of your brain. So when you connect with your heart in a way that's deeply passionate so that it's juicy and you get all that energy going and that and you have, as I put it, your whole heart into that picture becoming true, that's when you're really putting the energy out there. That's what you really need to be focusing. It isn't your mind that has to be so focused, although it does need to be focused. But the big piece, The one that's going to make the huge difference is your heart is all in it. You're passionate, and that energy is pouring out of you, moving forward. And as a little kid, I was very quickly passionate about becoming a millionaire, because it was immediately clear to me that my life was going to be different to grow up as a millionaire rather than someone living in a home that was just, you know, very average and not being able to pay the bills. But the third part now is that most visualization has you walking into the future. The problem is you don't live in the future. You live in the present. So what I have clients do, and I'll invite everyone when they do their visualization after this, to imagine that future ideal world you want to create moving toward you. And as it gets closer and closer and closer and closer, and it's close to your body now, allow it just into your body so that you fully embody the future right now. And in that state of having your heart and your mind and your body totally focused on this ideal life and world and future that you want, but you're living it now, right now. And that's what I did as a little kid. I became a millionaire in that moment, and that's why I carried it forward with me. It wasn't something that was going to be in the future. In fact, very quickly, within 2 or 3 years, I kept wondering, how in the world am I still living in a family that has no money? We're supposed to have money now. And so then take 3 actions just to start the momentum while you're still in that state that are moving you toward that goal. And that's really what I did as a little kid. If you think about it, I ran in the house because I wanted to announce my new world. I wanted to tell my parents about this new place that I was dwelling in inside of my whole body and being. That's the magic. And that's what real estate agents, when they do their visualization that way, they're fully embodying it and it becomes their truth. And everything that is out of accord with your truth feels wrong to you. So all of a sudden, it feels wrong that you're not making $100,000 a month, because inside, that's who you've become.
Got it. Okay. So that is super meaty. So let's try to break that down. Let's go back to when you're a kid. You're in real life, right? In your book, you outline these 4 steps. Now, your last step is to take 3 actions. And when you were a kid, that four.
I have it organized in 3. It's okay. Conscious. Get conscious of what you want.
Okay.
Get totally focused on it. And as you're focused, allow it to come into you, because that's part of the focusing process. And then the action part is to take 3 steps to begin the momentum.
Oh, got it. Okay. So sorry. My two and three, I blended. Okay. But
well, no, I can see how I presented it. I just wanted to get it that there's really the conscious focused action.
So, but what you did as a kid, the third piece or to take action, you did last. You didn't do first, right? You did last because you had this idea, you had this epiphany, right. Then you ran inside and told your mom. Now, and then once you told your mom, you broadcast it to the world. Then, right. then you started to create this rich visual world, right? So you drew pictures of mansions, and you made it kinesthetic.
Well, and also as a little kid, I should add, I was always creating little businesses. I was selling candles. I was selling cards. My father grew 100 acres of peanuts, so he helped me boil peanuts. And I was going around at age 7 with bags of peanuts, selling them first in the morning. And then my dad said, hey, you know, you can double your money if you sell them in the afternoon. My dad was great with ideas. And so I went around and I sold to the same people, and they got boiled peanuts from me twice a day. I was mowing lawns and had a little lawn mowing business when I was 9 years old. So I was always... From that point forward, I just began to look for ways to make money, and I saved it all. My parents couldn't get me to even buy a soda when we went to the store. Although I will add, I was fascinated by fireworks. And every summer we'd take a trip where we'd eat out of the car. We didn't have much money, but we'd go to these mom and pop motels back then. And we'd have, you know, chicken and boiled eggs and all this stuff that we kept in the car. And we'd buy sandwich meat. And on the way back home, we would stop, because in Florida back then you could do fireworks, but you couldn't usually buy them in Florida. And we'd stop in Georgia and Alabama, and I'd have maybe $30, but that bought a lot.
Yeah.
And I'd come back. And once a year, I did my fireworks for the whole town, and I put on this firework display. I went out on a dock, and we'd have a cookout, and it'd be the firework night that I did fireworks for the community. And I was doing that when I was 9 years old.
That's awesome. You should have charged for that.
I don't know. That was kind of, well, you know, I have a nonprofit that I'm want to be in 160 countries helping youth. We're doing our first Conscious World Day, June 21st. So I'm all about empowering youth and giving back. And my parents were about that as well. And they had that part down really well. So I, for me, there was just the joy of creating this major, you know, experience for everybody in town. It was really one of our only festivals, was my little fireworks I'd bring back every summer.
JV, the Crumbs night. Okay. But so I want to get back to, this because I really want to dig into the, your three steps, right? So as a kid, you created this world, you started drawing mansions, you made it kinesthetic and visual with smells because you drew three different dining rooms, right? You were very food motivated.
Oh yeah. I wanted one for breakfast, one for lunch.
One for dinner.
A big one for dinner.
And then another room for parties, right? So you made it. So in terms of your steps, so as a kid, you made it rich in your mind. Tell me then, your second step, right, is focus your mind, focus your whole being, your whole heart, and draw that into you. If I'm, you know, for my audience out there, right, they know what they want to accomplish. They know they want to sell 100 houses this year, or they want to do $30 or $50 million, or even just double their production. How do we do that? How do I do that, JV?
Yeah, great. Let's start. Whatever date you're listening to that, let's look at the end of 2014. I want you to immediately write down, if you're listening in the car, wait till you stop. But when you're at a place that you can sit down and do this, write down what your number is. What do you want to accomplish in sales, and what portion of that do you want to be yours? Because I mean, there are all kinds of ways you could be splitting. And then create your visualization of what that's like in terms of your life, and including making the sales, so that it's rich and full of sensory, visual, auditory, kinesthetic, the smells, the taste, everything that's real for you. And then let yourself connect, not just with your mind, but to your heart and the passion that you're going to feel for accomplishing that, how exciting it's going to be for you, and allow yourself to just gently believe in that moment, in the feeling of that moment of it all being done, and just move into that feeling while seeing that picture out there, and then imagine it. And I always close my eyes, imagine it floating toward you. And when it gets to you, and listen to my words very carefully, invite that ideal future, that December 31st, if this is 2014, when you're listening to it, 2014 or 2015, invite that into your being, like you were inviting a friend into your house, because you really want to have that kind of intimate relationship with the world that you want to create. And then as you embody that, notice how you begin to feel that this now is who you are. And we've all had moments like this, where we imagined something that wasn't true in this moment, and all of a sudden it was as if it were true. And that's what I'm talking about, because now you're embodying it. And as a little kid, that's exactly what I did. And then I went around joyfully believing and reigniting what we might call a state, reigniting that state over and over and over and over again. Now, there's an aside here. The people in your life, unless they're people that you just can't get rid of easily, those people need to disappear. You need to let those people leave if they're unwilling to believe in the world that you want to be creating, because you want people in your life that are going to support that. I've had to go through numerous, and everybody I know who's continually moved up in terms of higher and higher levels of success are constantly having to clean that people who don't want to take that journey, or at least don't want to support it, or don't want to be naysayers, aren't invited in their life, because those people will do everything they can to pop that balloon that you've created for yourself. But by living in that balloon and believing in the truth of who you really are deep down inside, because this now becomes cellular for you as you begin to integrate it into your being, that's why it's important to visualize day after day after day, and to allow yourself to become this new person that then literally emerges on the outside. So this old spiritual statement, as within, so without, is absolutely true. Your job is to create it within, and then take the actions that allow it to become your truth on the outside.
Right. So I can understand how you know, the repetition of this is important, because the first time that somebody's going to go and they're going to imagine the end of December 31st at the end of the year, whatever year, 2014, 2015, 2016, they're going to imagine the amount they want to make, a $1.2 million, $100,000 a month. So they're doing this imagination process, exercise, but there's another piece of you, little deep down inside you, that's going, that's not possible. You can't do it. Right. You have all this negative self-talk. How do you kill that? Is it the repetition that kills that? Is the reigniting that state? Is that how you kill that inner negativity?
Well, that's interesting. That opens up a very interesting area to talk about. So let's think of that part of you as just a part. That's one part of you. And it's not so much that you want to kill it or murder it. It's that you want to, in a clear way, say you're no longer welcome.
Yeah.
You're no longer welcome. And imagine yourself talking to your beliefs. I haven't had anybody bring this up in a while, but imagine yourself talking. You've got to first identify, become conscious that there's this belief in you that says this isn't possible, and acknowledge that. Don't deny it, because for everyone, there are these doubts. There are these negative beliefs. There are beliefs that at one time might have actually served you, but because now you're moving to a new place, what was once was way above where you are, now it might be a ceiling. And so it's stopping you from moving forward. So you have to constantly identify those, allow them to float up, and then invite them. Just say, you know, you're no longer welcome in this form. The beliefs that are welcome in me now are these beliefs. And literally go through a transformational process of identifying, what is it costing you to hold on to that belief and become conscious of that? What are you gaining? Because every belief you're holding on to in some way is serving you. It's just that you may be gaining things that are no longer functional for you. So what once might have been functional now is dysfunctional. And so it's holding you back. And then once you identify that, create the opposite belief and look at what's it going to cost you. What's it going to cost you not to have that belief, but more importantly, what are you going to gain from that belief, and how is your future going to be different? And then begin to embody that belief and invite that belief into your visualization process so that you're integrating it on a daily basis, this new belief, but there's a part of you that's never going to believe that belief until you take action on it. You've got to go out and take action so that you've got reference points that say this belief is true. I can go and meet someone new and invite them to look at homes, and they will. Or I can show three homes and I can ask someone which home they want to purchase and get them in a state of imagining owning that home and find out which home would be in their best interest and move the deal forward. But you know as well as I do, when you're in sales, until you have a reference point, you can't go forward to the next place. So you have to go get reference points by acting on the belief so that your whole mind and body is going, oh, this belief is obviously true. I just acted on it and I got the results I thought I would.
Interesting. And I hope everybody kept up with that. I mean, that's some thick stuff there, JV. So, you know, one of the very interesting pieces I got out of that was that all the beliefs that we have served us at one point, right? So if today what is negative, you know, if we're having a belief that's holding us back, at some point in our life, that belief served us for well. But today, yesterday's goal is today's ceiling.
Right.
Okay. So in order to beat that down or not, or so you said, identify that belief, identify those negative thoughts in you, and then invite them to leave.
Now, yeah, or change. You're going, hey, we're going in a new direction here.
Got it.
Like you would have a conversation with anybody else and just go, hey, we're going in a new direction. This is where we're headed now. And appreciate that, and, you know, express your appreciation. you know, even if you cannot see how it might have served you. Because remember, we go back to the little situation with my mom. I didn't choose to go this direction. I didn't choose to create a belief that I shouldn't be a millionaire because it would have pleased my mom. Although there are other beliefs that I created that probably were created just to please my mom, just to make my mom happy with
right.
me. So that would have, in that case, served a positive intention, which was making mommy or daddy happy with you, right? In my case, I just decided I'm going to go live a different life. I don't like this life. I don't like not being able to get the candy bar. I don't like us, you know, not being able to buy a nicer car. And I'm not going to live this way. So I made such a strong decision in literally a matter of a few moments that no one was ever going to convince me that I wasn't going to get it.
See, I learned something on this, right? I'm getting actually a new appreciation for mindset, right? We talk about mindset all the time, you know, manage your mindset. And even with my coaching, I talk about mindset. But the way that you framed mindset, you framed it in a way of really state management, right? If you can manage your state often enough, repetitive enough, that will transform your overall mindset. And really,
and it'll transform your actions.
And your being, right?
Remember,
and
it's conscious, being. Focused actions. So the whole point of this is to be taking different actions, which will then in turn get you different results.
Okay. Again, I really like the way that you've laid this out. And I wish we could somehow make it a little bit more simpler. But you know what? Maybe that's what your book's for, right?
Well, so, let's make it simple with a conscious focused action.
Okay.
In fact, I call that the formula for creating wealth. It's all the way through my book, is that there are only three steps to creating the results you want. The first one, in simple terms, is to get conscious of what you want. Think of who might be able to help you achieve it and what are the different options for getting there. So that's the conscious step. Then the focus step is to get your mind, your heart, and your body in a state of readiness. So they're all focused on moving forward towards that result you have now identified. And then the third step is just to take action. And let me make that simple. You ask yourself, which actions do you want to take? What order should they be in? And when should you start? That's how simple it is. Conscious, focused action. And when you do that over and over again, and you notice the results you're getting, so then you might fine tune some of the actions, or you might say, hey, I need to get Joe along with Sally. I need a couple of people to help me. So you're constantly iterating that. You will get to the results that you want. It's that simple.
Got it. No, okay. Yeah, that's a simple piece of it. Okay. So what about, you know, as we go along, we have these big goals for the end of the year, December 31st. You know, how is celebrating the little wins, right? Getting those reference points, as you mentioned earlier, how are celebrating those or getting reference points as we go along? How important is that?
It's critical. It just as it's critical to chunk it down so you get clear about where you want to be on December 31st. And you remember, I want to throw this in because this is very important, that success, growth of a business, growth of sales, any type of growth curve is actually logarithmic. And by that, I mean, in the early stages, you'll have a small amount of those sales. And as you continue to build momentum and build momentum and build momentum, it'll all of a sudden that curve will steepen.
Right.
So it may be that in the last quarter of the year, you might get half of your results because you've been working towards them, planting the seeds, getting the contracts going, but you might have a contract that doesn't close for 60 days or 90 days. So that's what I mean by it's logarithmic. It's not straight line. So if you're wanting to make $1 million in commissions this year, it's unlikely that it's going to be the same amount every month. You're going to be building so that the last month may be 200,000.
Right.
And a lot of people don't think about that. And so they go, oh, this month I didn't get my 100,000. Well, yes, but you were planting seeds. You were going out there and doing the right things. You were learning what was working. You were getting clients. You were getting referrals. And all of those things, if you continue to do them day after day after day, become like this. It's like social media is. If you add 5 people every day, imagine where you'd be at the end of the year. Last year in January on my LinkedIn, for example, I had 750 connections. which a lot of people would think was good, but I decided I really wanted to expand that. And in January, I was at New Media Expo where we met. So it was the first week of January. I went to a class on LinkedIn for an hour, got some basic ideas of what I wasn't doing. And then I played with those and iterated. In 14 months, I've gone from 750 to over 4,800 relevant connections and put myself in the top 1% of LinkedIn worldwide in terms of page views and number of connections, simply because day after day after day, I did the same thing. And then I would improve it the next day and I go, ah, I noticed this distinction that worked. And therefore, I'll do this. And then I would see, okay, that's working. Then I'd wonder, okay, well, I wonder what different I could do, what new thing I could try out. And I'd try out something and sometimes it'd work and sometimes didn't seem like it was getting any results. So I'd let go of it. But every day I worked on my LinkedIn. And in a simple path of 14 months, I went from 750 to 4,800 connections.
Right. And, you know, and so
real estate's the same way.
Exactly right. So, you know, it's that getting that flywheel going, right? And how, I mean, I love the way you said that, you know, it's not linear, but it's exponential.
Well,
you said logarithmic.
To play on those numbers, I went from 7,500 to in November, I was at 3,300. But this year alone, and then December, I was going to a lot of things, and I think I added like 100 or so. But this year alone, I've gone from a little over 3,400 to 4,800, so I've almost at 4,900. So I've added in a little over nine weeks, I've added 1,400 connections. So the huge chunk came in the last 2 months.
Right.
And that's that logarithmic curve. But it's because everything starts spreading out and more people start sending me invitations because all of a sudden you're getting this spider web going on.
Right. See, you know, that's amazing. I'm glad you brought that up because, you know, I have, you know, on my show, as everybody knows, you know, I talk with people who do $50 million, $80 million, $100 million in business. And I try to uncover how they got there. And a lot of these people have been in business for a long time and some of them have no good answers. They're like, well, you know, just go out. If you want to do what I do, go out and build a referral business. But I'm like, but I go, you know what? For the guy who's doing 10 deals, he can't do that, right? Like, so for you, you know, and what you're saying for that flywheel, you know, you're not going to see results next month. You're not going to results in 4 months. You know, it's at the end of the year. And once you get that flywheel going, it just starts turning. It's that momentum.
Well, yeah, because think in basically 2 months, I've added 1,400 people. But when I came back from January and I'm playing with it, I mean, initially I was adding like maybe 50 people in a month, you know, or 100 people in a month. I wasn't adding, you know, basically 700 in a month. It took momentum. I had to figure out what was working. I had to work at it day after day. And now it's, you know, at a completely different place.
So in terms of going back to mindset real quick, you know, so, you know, you need to be conscious. You'll create that rich visual, you know, kinesthetic idea, you know, focus it, you know, and get your, not just your brain, but your heart and, you know, and then, you know, see that end result moving towards you. Where is in that three-step process of yours, JV? Where do people get stuck?
They stop themselves. And I think it has to do with an internal self-sabotage around worthy and deserve, which, you know, every person listening to this, because I'll say it's certainly in me that, you know, I've now set my goal that I want 100 million net worth. A lot of the reasons I've chosen that, and I have something I want to do with all that money, and a lot of it's going to go to my nonprofit. But a huge portion of that journey is about the personal growth that has to occur and the quality and level of person that I'm going to befriend as I go along that journey. That's what helps keeping me moving forward. And so a lot of times people don't have a meaningful why. I have a meaningful why. I have a lot of reasons that it makes sense for me to have $100 million. So a lot of people don't have meaningful whys. They have whys that are ones they think they're supposed to have, or their wife or husband, or their mother or father, or their sister or brother wants for them, or they just think it's the right thing to do. But they aren't invested for themselves. It isn't their why. And it's only your why that's meaningful to you that's going to really get you motivated to keep moving forward. And without that, all these techniques aren't going to work. because you're never really going to fully engage them because you don't have a full reason to.
So, yeah, right. And you know, we talk about, or I personally talk about finding your why a lot, right? You need to find your why, but it's easier said than done. Can you tell us a little bit about, for the people who don't understand that concept, know your why or find your why, what, expand on that, unpack that a little bit, and then tell us, give us some tips on how to get there.
Sure. Well, I have a different approach, and I think by now you can see that I kind of work in threes. That's how I think. And so most of my strategies have three parts to them. So most people, when they're getting motivated, only look at most two out of what I think are six parts to this. There's three parts in the present, and the present goes until the goal you have is achieved. And then there's three parts in the future, which start when you achieve the goal and move forward. So the first part is, what's in it for me? What's in it for me? And that's important. However, most motivations kind of begin with, what's in it for me to accomplish this goal? So that's one part that you could have as your motivation. And then, but they don't really fully engage, well, what's in it for me in the next year, that if I accomplish this year, next year, that's my floor, and I get to start from there and go to this new ceiling, this right. new place, right? But the second part of it is, what's in it for others? And by others, I suggest choose someone who is meaningful and important to you. It might be your spouse. It might be your children. It might be helping out a parent or someone you care about. It might be your clients. But imagine someone specific. If you can't cut out a picture from a magazine and know who that other person is, you're not yet clear about the person you want to help. And it has to be someone that helping them touches you in the heart. It's meaningful. That's what I mean by meaningful. It's, you have a place for it in your heart. And then look at, by you accomplishing this, how is it going to help them? It may be that you have the funds to help them. It may be that you've set an example for your children about how you actually achieve success. It may be that you've been able to send them to a better school, or you've been able to take a great family vacation that gives them experiences they wouldn't have had. So now they have rich reference points about what's possible in their life. But so you look at that in the now, between, and by now I mean the present of right now and the achievement of your goal, the end of the year. And then ask, well, okay, if let's say your child has these sets of experiences this year, and next year you're even more successful, what kind of experiences can they have next year? But think of it in terms of their eyes. They've learned to experience life in a different way because you've made it possible for them, because you've had the ability to show them examples, because they now see you being successful, and you can explain to them, you know, this is how you create success. This is the step you take. This is the next step. This is the following step. And you could help them achieve their successes by doing the same thing. Then the following year, they've got those skills, they have those experiences, and they get to build on them. Then the third part of all this is, how does it impact your community, society, the world you live in? And again, make that specific. Is it the neighborhood you live in? Is it the town or city you live in that you're going to create a way that you can give back by usually getting involved in some cause where you may be able to contribute time or money or be on their board or in some way just take on a project that you want the world to be better? Because you're able to help in this way. Because a rich life, a fulfilling life, really is about stewardship and giving back. And I think that's very important. All the people I know who are wealthy and happy have a life of contribution. And so that other society part is really about contribution. How is your community different? It may be that because you've grown as a salesperson that you need two or three assistants. And so now you've provided employment and those people are able to provide and go out and buy from merchants in your city. And there's that trickling out effect because now you've been able to provide an income to people. And then look at, well, how then is your community at the end of the year different, and now that community starting a new place next year, and how much more different will it be by the end of the following year? So now you have this rich, what I call 2x3 matrix of yourself, others, and society between now and the end of the year. And how has all that changed? And then next year, how are they all going to change because they're starting at a different floor?
Right.
That's pretty powerful motivation.
That is awesome, man. I you know, look, all your stuff, JV, is it, you know, I love because it's, you know, you have a way of chunking everything down and visualizing each piece, and then again, you did a really good job talking about how, you know, the spidering effect of everything, social media, your vision, your why. So, hey, JV, thanks so much for coming on the show. It's been fantastic. I mean, you have really dropped the goods here. I'm sure everybody is, this is going to be one of those ones where everybody has to listen to two or three times, and then maybe go back to it next month to get it all. There's really a lot of stuff. So JV, tell everybody where they can find you. And I think you said you had some, something you wanted to give the audience.
Yep. I have a couple of gifts for everyone. So my book's come out. It's a bestseller. I'm incredibly delighted and feel blessed. What I'd like to do is give you a small version, take a couple of chapters. I put together a mini version of the book. I want to give that to you. We have a membership site. I want to give you 30 days in that. We have 17 videos based on the book that give you videos of examples of how to take the material and actually put it into action and get results, you know, starting right now today, because as you can hear, I'm all about the results. I want you to all be millionaires. I believe you can be. More importantly, I'd like for you to be conscious millionaires. And by that, people who are building their wealth in a way that makes the world better, makes their clients better off, and it's done with honesty and integrity. I want you to know you never have to violate any of your core values, that you can be a good human being. That was one of the things that my mom didn't know, and that contributed to a lot of the scarcity, because I had very intelligent parents. In fact, I used to sit around wondering, how are my parents so successful and they don't have money? Well, it was the belief system was not supporting them being okay with being wealthy. And so the final message I want for everyone is that I want you to know it's absolutely not only okay, but it's only by creating a life that is rich and abundant and filled with the money that you want that you're able to make the contribution in the world, that you're able to help people buy the homes that they really enjoy, and you're able to then go out and create a great example for your children, help your parents, give to causes that you believe in. And all of that comes from being financially successful. Being financially successful is good. It's not bad. And I think it's right for everyone. And that's why I support people moving forward on their path to their financial destiny.
Awesome. Well, everybody can go check out his book at consciousmillionaire.com. That's his website. And the giveaway here, if everybody goes to www.consciousmillionaire/superagents, is it superagents?
Well, it's consciousmillionaire.com/superagents.
Super agents. And yeah. You can get that. You can get the access to the videos, get access to his membership site, and get a portion of his book.
Right. I'm going to give you a couple of chapters of the book. It's about 60 pages long and filled with exercises, so you can get started right now today.
It's free. Go get it. And if you've missed anything, go back to superagentslive.com/JV Crum III. JV, thanks so much.